Once again, we are live from Washington, D.C. this morning. The Diamond Sutra, Pure Paradise Land. We are also live via Facebook video. The Sufi word for meditation is Maraqba. Maraqba means waiting. What are we waiting for? Just as when you are trying to connect to internet, you have switched on and you are waiting for server to connect to you. Sometimes it takes a little while to connect to the server. If the internet is working slow, it takes a little while to connect. Otherwise, it connects instantaneously. During meditation, we are connecting to that realm, that source of energy, that source of light. Sufis term this as alami ghaib, that realm beyond the known, where the masters dwell after they leave the physical world. Or even when they are in the physical world, they want to connect you to the energy level. As such as I am, or you are a physical body, emotional body, then other layers. The meditation happens when you are connected to the light body. The light or energy is synonym for the same thing. Light, you are connected to the light. It begins to descend in you, and in that process, it activates various centers. It begins to work just as when you turn on the light in a room that has been dark. Everything becomes incandescent and begins to show. You can correct it. One thing that is very important for meditation is that we need to keep the spine as straight as possible. Once the spine is straight, the flow of energy is not disturbed. So when we sit down on a couch, as my position is, the back is leaning backward. It's supposed to be creating a 90 degree angle with the earth or the ground where you are sitting. This is an important aspect in the meditation. And with that, there comes a state of surur or bliss. You are drowning in that and let it work on its own. This is the essence of the meditation. The Diamond Sutra, Pure Land Paradise. I have spoken to you in one of the lives when Buddha was not enlightened. Siddhartha, Gautam, Buddha, he was not enlightened then. He happened to come to a Buddha named Deepankar. Deepankar was sitting, and as Buddha came, he bowed down to Deepankar. But then something strange happened. Deepankar also got up from the seat where he was sitting, and he bowed to Siddhartha. This baffled Gautam, he asked, "You are enlightened and I am not. I am a seeker. When I bow down to you, it is acceptable. But I do not understand, why did you bow down to me?" Deepankar said something very strange. "It is not strange, it may be. Each seed has the potentiality to become a flower. And when you look at the garden, you go to the garden, there are many birds that are coming onto the surface. One bud blossoms today. The gardener knows that this bud is ready, but it will blossom only tomorrow. So he cuts the rose buds for sale in the market. This bud is ready to blossom today. That bud will blossom tomorrow, so on and so forth. Each individual has to blossom and attain to its fruition. Today I have blossomed. Tomorrow is your chance. Day after tomorrow, maybe 5 more buds may blossom. The process goes on." So he said, "My life has come to an end. I have blossomed. But I am seeing in you that soon the blossoming will happen to you. So I am paying my respect to a flower that is yet to blossom. And when you will attain to fruition, I will not be alive. So I am paying the respect to you now." This particular session of the talk relates to the dialogue between Buddha and Subhuti regarding Deepankar. Although I said it is a dialogue, but sometimes it happens that although in Diamond Sutra Subhuti did not ask and Buddha did not say anything, it was a silent communion, and Ananda reports that. Imagine a situation when mother and daughter talking and they don't want anybody else to hear. They talk in silent gestures. And if you are accustomed, familiar to know the kind of gestures the mother and daughter do, you will be able to figure out what they are actually saying. Sometimes the lover and beloved talk in silent language. The words do not flow. All communication happens in silence. When mother and the daughter are conspiring, it is better to use the word, for something for their father they don't want him to know, and all of a sudden the father is spotted, the words disappear and silent communion happens. But if you are smart enough, you will know what they are up to their sleeves. So you just skip it. So something like that happened between Subhuti and Buddha. There can be no better example than to explain to you what would have happened between Subhuti and Buddha. Silent communion, but Ananda is smart enough. He knows what is going on and he reports it for us. The Lord asked, "What do you think, Subhuti? Is there any dham, the principle, which Tathagat has learned from Deepankar? Do you think that Tathagat is the name for Buddha. Just as Farid used to say, for him, he removed the I, he used to say sister. So he used the third person, does not say I. Instead, he uses the word Tathagat, thus came, thus gone. The Lord asked, what do you think, Subhati? Is there any dhamma which the Tathagat has learned from Deepankar? Subhati replied, not so, O Lord, there is not. The Lord said, if any Bodhisattva would say, I will create harmonious Buddha field, he would speak falsely. I am not creating any harmonious Buddha field or anything. Things happen on its own. It's not my doing. The moment I think or I say that I am creating the meditativeness, no. All the people together, sitting in harmony, their presence brings that energy force, opens that source of light, and it begins to flow. The moment earth begins to lament for the raindrops to fall, the clouds respond and begins to shower. The shower is the response of the call of the earth, a request that I am thirsty, and the cloud responds, you are all thirsty for that shower, begins to happen. The harmonies of Buddha field, Subhati, as no harmonies, have they been taught by Tathagat? Therefore he speaks of harmonious Buddha field, the Lord said. And again, Subhati, suppose a woman or a man were to announce. And again, Subhati, suppose a woman or a man were to renounce all their belongings as many times as are the grains of sand in the river Ganges. And suppose that someone else, after taking from these discourses on Dhamma, but one stanza of four lines, would demonstrate it to others, then this later of the strength of that would beget a greater heap of merit. It is wonderful, O Lord. It is exceedingly wonderful. O welcome. How well the Tathagat has taught this discourse on Dhamma through its cognition has been produced by me, and it is indeed no prescription. Deepankar is an ancient Buddha. Gautam Buddha, in the past lives when he was not enlightened, has gone to the company of Deepankar just as we all do. He wanted to be accepted as a disciple, but Deepankar laughed and said, there is nothing to be learned. Truth cannot be learned. Yes, something has to be understood. But nothing has to be learned. Truth cannot be learned. What kind of a statement is this? Truth has to be understood because it is existing. That which exists only you have to understand, but nothing has to be learned. Truth has to be recognized. It is already there in your being. It has to be uncovered. But there is nothing to learn. Truth is not new. It is your very being. You have to become aware of it. Not that you have to become more knowledgeable. Truth is not knowledge. In fact, the more knowledgeable you are, less aware you will be. The more you think you know, the more will be covered with ignorance. Knowledge is ignorance. The knowledgeable person is covered with dark clouds of memory, information, scriptures and philosophy. He is always speaking in terms of scriptures, memory, uses the memory to bring about all that. Deepankar said to Gautam, you need not think in terms of learning. Truth is already in you. Truth is the seed that you are born with. Just as the seed that you go and buy from the market, a flower seed, that is a potentiality that carries the truth that is a flower. Flower is hidden in its womb. Only thing is this, you have to create an environment for that flower to blossom, that truth to be uncovered. The truth that seed contains in its womb, the flower, that has to be discovered. Truth is already in you. It cannot be transferred. When the gardener buys a seed or a plant, does he transfer anything to it? All he does, he prepares a flower bed, plants the seed, and waits for it to grow in its own natural way. He does not transfer anything, does not give it any discourse. All it shares, plants it, takes care of it lovingly, that it is not being in the process. When the seed is becoming seedling, it protects it from any kind of animals or anything to destroy it. Truth is already in you. It cannot be transferred. It has to be allowed to grow into you. Just as the seed is to be allowed to grow in the flower bed. Not only this, when Gautam touched the feet of Deepankar, Deepankar bowed down and touched the feet of Gautam. Gautam was not enlightened then. He was very puzzled and embarrassed too. If, according to Indian traditions, the boys, they are supposed to touch the feet of the father. But if the father touches the feet of the child may feel embarrassed. But it happened to Gautam. There was a great assembly of monks. Nobody could understand what was happening. Deepankar has never done anything like this before. And Gautam said, what have you done? Why have you touched my feet? I am a sinner, an ignorant person. To touch your feet is right, but your touching my feet is absurd. Have you gone mad? And Deepankar laughed again and he responded, no, Gautam. You are puzzled because you know not your future. The bud does not know when it will blossom. What will be its hue? What would be its color? How strong will be its fragrance? What size will it blossom? But the gardener knows. He has removed all the other buds and all the nourishment goes to that particular bud. It attains to the optimum size. No, Gautam, you are puzzled. Because you know not your future and I am not mad. I can see it happening. You will be a Buddha soon. Just to honor that fact, I have touched your feet. And moreover, for one who is enlightened, all are enlightened. If you have tasted that enlightenment, for you, everyone is enlightened. Only the enlightened one indeed can recognize another enlightened one, even in the seed form. The gardener recognizes the seed. From the seed, the nature of the flower. It is only a question of time. It does not matter much. I have become enlightened today. You will become enlightened tomorrow. And someone else will become enlightened the day after tomorrow. Indeed, it does not matter. The process has begun. When one flower blossoms, the season of spring has come. One flower is followed by another, and so on and so forth, until all the buds have blossomed. Enlightenment is going to happen to everyone, to every being. You can go on delaying it, and that is up to you. The moment you stop delaying, the moment you stop postponing, it is there. It has always been waiting for you to recognize it. Each seed has to sprout and each bud has to blossom into flower. The bud sees the gardener coming. Gardener comes with the scissors in his hand. He is trading in the cut flowers. He cuts out those buds which are ready to go in the market. Looking at the gardener coming with the scissors in his hand, the buds are talking among them. Today is my chance, I will be picked up because I have blossomed, I am ready. Tomorrow will be your chance and thus will continue the process. Each seed has to sprout and each bud has to blossom into flower. This is the destiny. Neither you nor I can change it. Deepankar touching the feet of Gautam is one of the most beautiful anecdotes. And Gautam was unknown then. And after centuries, nearly 300 years later, when Gautam was born as Siddharth and he became enlightened. And when this happened for the first time that Gautam, the first thing that Gautam did, he bowed down to Deepankar. But Deepankar was not there. Which direction he should turn his face to bow down? Deepankar is a spirit. In the end, he has become the cosmic. He is a spirit like a vast canopy. Which direction should Deepankar bow down? Which direction is Deepankar is staying? Which direction should Buddha turn his face to bow down? But he remembered the words of Deepankar, and these continue to echo into his being like the dissolving notes of an enchanting melody. The words of Deepankar continue to echo into his being like the dissolving notes of an enchanting melody, that one day you will blossom and you will attain to Buddhahood. And he laughed and said, now I understand. Why did you touch my feet? Now I can touch the feet of everyone. Now I know the whole existence is going to be enlightened. Through these sutras, Buddha is paying his gratitude to Deepankar and making Subhuti aware of this as well. Also through the Diamond Sutra, he is revealing the great secret for the humanity. Enlightenment is a natural happening. If you do not hinder, it is bound to happen. It is not that you have to achieve it at all, or all you can do is hinder it. You go on hindering it in 1001 ways. You do not allow it to happen. When it starts happening, you become frightened. When it takes possession of you, you shrink back and withdraw. You come back in your tiny cell of ego. How can I accept another master? I am already connected to one. But you can appreciate. You can be in the company. Master is not a person. If you consider master as a person, you are erroneous. You have not understood this state. Master is a state of awakening. When that awakening has come to you, you have become a master. Master is a state of awareness. Never ask who is the master. Instead ask, what is a master? When your question is wrong, who is a master? You enter into the realm of ego, personality. When you ask, what is a master? You are entering into a methodology. Master is a state of awareness. Master is a state of awakening. Once that state begins to manifest through one, that person have attained the state of masterhood. And ultimately, there is no one, no many masters. The only master is the existence. The light is the master. And when this light manifests through you, you are reflecting that light of the sun. The moon, the stars, they are reflecting the light of the sun. Sun is the ultimate source of life, ultimate source of light, and everything else becomes alive when sun rises. Enlightenment is a natural happening. If you do not hinder, it is bound to happen. When it starts happening, you become frightened. When it takes possession of you, you cannot give that much possession. You shrink back and withdraw. You come back in your tiny cell of ego. There you feel protected, defended and secure. And once again you lose the opportunity of being enlightened. You do not know when the next chance comes. You are standing in the queue and you miss the opportunity. You have to wait for the entire turn cycle to complete, for your turn to come again. Enlightenment is the open sky of insecurity. It is vastness. It is uncharted ocean. The journey is from one unknown to another unknown realm. There is nothing that can be known. Knowledge, the very idea of knowing, is part of human stupidity and imbecility. Life is such a mystery that it cannot be known. Life is mystery, you have to live it. And if it cannot be known, how can it be taught? And if it cannot be taught, what is the point of being a master and disciple? The master and disciple is a drama, is a game. Play it as beautiful as possible. To you, it is a reality. I know. To a master, it is a drama. From your side, it is a great reality. From the side of the master, it is a game. One day you will understand that it is a game. The seed is already a flower. So there is nothing that I can do to it. Yet still the whole episode takes place from the time the seed is brought from the shelf and until it blossoms. You are taking care that it does not go into its own narrow shell. It does not begin to shrink. One day you will also understand that this is all a game, and that day will be the day of your enlightenment. That day you will become aware that, and you will know that there is no master, no disciple. The day you will understand, you will know it was a dream-like. However, this dream can help you to come out of your other dreams. Only one dream remains. It is like a thorn which can help to pull out your thorn from the flesh. A thorn has pricked you. Now, how are you going to take it out? You can use another thorn to take it out. Deepankar was simply saying to Gautam, when he touched his feet, that this is just a game. You touch my feet and I touch your feet. It makes no difference. We are all enlightened. We are all gods. Not that I am God and you are not. All is divine. The tree is God. So are the animals. So is everything, even rock. But the level of consciousness differs in each, the plants, rocks, and that God is asleep in the rocks. He has become a little alert in the plants, a little more alert in animals, a little more alert in you. In a Buddha, he has come perfectly to absolute alertness. The level of awakening, the level of alertness has reached its pinnacle in the Buddha. This difference is not of quality. Instead, the difference is of quantity. You take a water from the ocean in a spoon. It does not mean that it does not have the quality of the ocean's water. It does. But the quantity is very small, a drop or a bucket or the whole ocean. And if you are this much aware, you can become that much aware too. He is asking, have I learned anything from Deepankar? Buddha asked Subhuti. There is nothing to learn. Truth is a given fact. Whatsoever you learn will be lies. Truth need not be learned. Truth has not to be invented, but only discovered. Better will it be to say that truth has only to be rediscovered. Indeed, everyone has to rediscover it deep within. And the word learning is dangerous. Learning implies accumulated information. The more you accumulate information, the deeper your reality goes into unconscious. You become burdened. Your head starts clamoring with knowledge. It becomes noisy. And then you cannot hear the still small voices that your heart continues to echo. The space that the heart is begins to shrink. The silence of heart is lost in the noise of knowledge. That is why even the sinners achieve and it is easier for them, but the scholars miss. The sinner can stumble, but the scholar cannot be humble. Sinner can be humble, but not the scholar. The sinner can cry and weep, but the scholar knows he is adamant in his knowledge. He is egoistic. In his knowledge, he cannot melt. He is not open. He is closed and even remains so. All his knowledge and doors are blocked by his knowledge. To come to truth means unlearning rather than learning. You have to unlearn all that you have known. The Zen tradition of Buddhism says you learn the art of archery, but you have learned. After you have learned, you allow it, you forget all about it for maybe the same number of years. Then it will grow into you as part of your own growth. If you have learned cooking, you have interest. Each time you have to cook, you have to go into the recipe book, try to remember that. But when you have done it, you left it, allow it to become part of you, then you don't need to go into the recipe, you have to cook anything. You just go into yourself and you will be able to figure out the entire recipe once again. It surfaces from within you. It is not a learning but unlearning process. To unlearn is the way. If you can unbecome, then you can be capable of becoming once again. If you are capable of unlearning, and if you can drop all knowledge, conditionality, without any clinging, you will become innocent. It is only innocence that can bring you back home. And Jesus says, in response to a question, who can enter the kingdom of your father, one who is childlike. Childlike innocence, we give example. Between master and the teacher, what is transferred? Neither the truth nor knowledge is transferred. Then what is transferred? In fact, nothing is transferred between Deepankar and Gautam. In the presence of the master, something arises in the deepest core of the disciple. Not that it is transferred. Nothing travels from the master to the disciple, but the presence of the master, and something that was deep inside starts surfacing in the disciple. The presence of the master calls for the being of the disciple. The presence of the master calls forth the being of the disciple. It is not that something is given or transferred. It is not that something is being transferred. Just the very presence of the master becomes a catalyst and the disciple starts changing. A catalyst does nothing in the chemical reaction. However, the presence of the catalyst is important, and in that presence alone the chemical reaction takes place. Of course, a disciple will think that something is being done by the master. I am telling you something so deep that you will never know master once you understand, can feel that he is doing something. Just a presence I am creating. That I am present around you, and in that presence the flower begins to blossom. Of course, a disciple will think that something is being transferred. Nothing indeed is being done. No real master ever does anything. All he is doing consists of a presence that surrounds you. It is being available to you. All his work consists of one simple thing, a subtle presence. He surrounds you like the sun. What is the connection between the blossoming of a flower and the sun? Sun is so far away. Sun has risen. It surrounds you like a presence. And in that presence, something starts blossoming from within the flower itself, the bud itself, and its petals begin to open. The sun rises in the morning, the bud open and become flower. Not that sun gives them anything. Not that sun comes and opens the bud or tells them, wake up, it's time for you to open. Nothing is done by the sun. Just the presence of the light is enough and bud starts opening. The opening comes from the bud itself, and the flowering and the fragrance all comes from the bud itself. The sun has not added anything to it, But the presence of the sun is the catalyst. Without the sun there, the bud would find almost impossible to open. It would not know that opening is possible. It would never become alert of its possibilities and potentials. A master simply makes you aware of your potential. If he has achieved, you too can achieve. He is just like you, the blood and bones and the body. He is just like you. If something is possible in his being, if this bud can become a flower, then why can't the other bud? Why can't you flower? This very idea sinks deep into the heart, stirs your whole being, and the energies start surfacing. In that your bud begins. This is called, in the East, satsang. Sat means truth. Sang means communion, the communion of truth. Master is embodiment of truth, and in his company, there is a communion. To be in the presence of the master and the real disciple is one who has come to know how to be present, how to be available to the master. The master is present, but how to be present to a master? Have you ever seen sunflower? That is the symbol for the disciple. Wherever the sun moves, the sunflower moves that way. It moves the direction of the sun. It is always present to the sun. In the morning it is facing east, and in the evening it is facing the west. It has moved with the sun. Wherever the sun is, the sunflower moves. The sunflower is a metaphor for disciple. There can be no better metaphor for a disciple than sunflower. Buddha is asking, do you think, Subhati, I have learned anything from the Panka? Subhati says, not so, Lord, because there is nothing to learn. Does it mean Buddha is ungrateful to the Panka? No, not at all. When he became enlightened, the first gratitude was towards the Panka, who had disappeared into the infinite long ago, and not even a trace was left behind. He exists only in the memory of Buddha, nowhere else. The words of Deepankar still linger deep down Buddha. After being enlightened, the first thing that Buddha did was to pay his gratitude to Deepankar. About Deepankar, there is no scripture. Maybe in those days scriptures were not written. There exists no reference about him. The reference about Deepankar only comes in the talk of Buddha when he mentioned. 3,000 years have passed. Nobody knows anything about Deepankar. But when Buddha became enlightened, for the first gratitude, the first thankfulness that he paid was towards Deepankar. Why? Because it was in the presence of Deepankar that longing in Buddha became a passion to become a Buddha. It was in the presence that a great desire to become a Buddha arose in him. It was in the presence that the bud of Gautam started dreaming of becoming a flower. It was in the presence that the dream unfolded. It took 3,000 years to drop the hindrances, the obstacles. But what are 3,000 years in the eternity of time? Nothing, just a few moments. Why is Buddha asking Subhuti? So that Subhuti can understand that there is nothing to be learned from Buddha. Buddha himself has not learned anything from Deepankar. So too, there is nothing. Subhuti, to learn from me, be with me, but do not think in terms of learning. The moment you think in terms of learning, you are not with me. There are two types of people, the disciple and the students. The students are those who are in search of learning something. They are here to gather something so that they can brag about and say that they know this and they know that. They are just collecting colored stones while diamonds are available. The disciple is the one who is not interested in knowledge, who is interested in being, who is interested just to be here with me, for no reason, for no other motive. His heart has been touched, his dreams have started unfolding, and a great intense desire is arising in him. Once a disciple was saying that he becomes afraid of death, I inquired him, "What have you become afraid of?" His reply was immensely beautiful. He said, "My fear is not because of death. The fear is because I have not known anything, not yet realized anything about death. I have not yet felt anything and I am afraid I might die without knowing the truth. That is my fear." A disciple is one who has become immensely interested in being, in truth itself, not knowing about it. He is not afraid of death. He is afraid that death may come and may disturb the intimacy that is arising between him and the master. Death may come and may disrupt the presence that he is imbibing, the presence that is going into his being and changing 1001 things in his soul. That alone is the fear. A disciple is never bothered about knowing, but is interested in being. Not that he wants to know something about God, but he wants to taste the God, to drink out of that reservoir called God, to become part of that oceanic presence. Remember, to be a student here is not very wise. To be a student here is most unintelligent thing. It is not a school. Life is available here in its pristine beauty, for which you have to be a disciple. It is the brewery of the master, where constantly pristine wine is being brewed. To be a disciple means to be courageous enough to come close to the master, whatsoever be the cost. The disciple means one who can risk of being close to a master. It is a risk because you will die. The bud will die. Only then flower can blossom. When bud dies as it is, then it becomes a flower. The seed will die, only then the plant will emerge. You will have to die, only then God can blossom in you. Die as you are. God will blossom through your ashes. God will blossom through your ashes. The truly wise gives you his being, not words. The truly wise simply makes him available to you, and if you are courageous, you can drink and eat out of his being. That is why Jesus means, when he says to his disciple, "Eat me, drink me," the master has to be eaten, the master has to be absorbed, digested. Only then will you stumble upon your own truth. There is nothing to learn, no dhamma, no doctrine to learn, no philosophy to learn. The word Buddha field is of tremendous importance. It has to be understood, because that is what I am doing through these talks and works. All these are aimed at creating a Buddha field. By creating a Buddha field, we are moving away from the world, far away, so that a totally a different kind of energy can be made available to you, and you can live in the world of such an enlightened awareness. Buddha field means creating a situation where sleeping Buddha in you can be awakened. Buddha field means an energy field where you can start growing, maturing, where your sleep can be broken, where you can be shocked into awareness. It is an electric field where you will not be able to fall asleep, where you will have to be awake because shocks will be coming all the time. The Buddha field is an energy field in which a Buddha matures being, a pure land, an unworldly world, which offers ideal conditions for rapid spiritual growth. It is a matrix. The word matrix is of a Latin origin. It means a womb. From that word you get the word matter, mother, and so on and so forth. The womb offers three things to a newly forming life. It is a source of possibility. It provides source of energy to explore that possibility. It is a safe place within which that exploration takes place. That is what this Buddha field is going to do to you through these talks, meditation. Video energies are being made available to you. This will bring a clear understanding of the possibilities. It is aimed at making you aware of your potential by creating a safe environment to work without being distracted by the world. It aims at how to become a Buddha, and everything else simply disappears from your mind. Money, power, prestige, or anything else. In the silence of that Buddha field, and the uninhibited atmosphere the master and the disciple can enact in drama totally. The ultimate is when master can touch the feet of the disciple, and the master and the disciple are lost into one reality. This is what Deepankar said to Buddha. Only a person who has no I within him can create a Buddha field. In fact, then to say that he is creating is not right. But language is inadequate. The Sanskrit word for creation is better. The Sanskrit word, it means many things. It can mean to create, to accomplish, to ripen, to mature, or it can simply mean to trigger into existence. That is exactly the meaning. A Buddha does not create, instead he triggers. Even to say triggers is not good. Always in his presence things happen. Or in his presence things are triggered. A process starts. His presence is a spark of fire. And things start moving. And one thing leads to another. And in the process a great change is created. Man has lived a long time the way he has lived. A time has come for a critical quantum leap. Either man will die in woe, or man can take a jump and will become a new man. Before that happens, a great Buddha field is needed. A field where we can create the new man. But a Bodhisattva cannot say, I will create the harmonious Buddha field. If the emphasis is on I, then the person is not yet a Bodhisattva. Even Buddhas use the word I. But they insistently emphasize that it corresponds to no reality. It is just a language use. It is just utilitarian. And Buddha says those harmonious Buddha feel are not even harmonious. Because harmony means conflict is still alive. Harmony means conflicting parts are there, but they are no longer creating any conflict. Buddha says the real harmony is when conflicting parts dissolve into one unity. When the musician tune into their instruments, each instrument is separate by itself. It has its own separate tune, separate musical ambience. When they start tuning in, one sound merges into the other and keeps on dissolving into the other, and after that there is not many instruments but only one sound. When all the various discordant elements into your being start dissolving into one another, there is one harmony. It's not the parts are dissolving. The sound of harmonium dissolves into that of percussion instrument, and together they dissolve into the wind instruments, and finally there is not many instruments, only one instrument plays. Harmony means that there are many fragments in the harmonious whole. Buddha says the real harmony is when those many discordant ones are no longer there and they have become one. So a harmony, a real harmony, cannot even be called harmony. It is simply a unity. There is no conflict, no friction, because all fragmentary parts have dissolved into one another. Remember again and again, it is a question of inadequate language. That is why Buddha goes on insisting again and again to remind you that you cannot become a victim of inadequate language expressions. The process continues. Buddha says that even if somebody demonstrates one stanza or four line from the Diamond Sutra, his merit is more. Indeed, his merit is immeasurable and incalculable, more than the merit of a man or a woman who were to renounce their belongings as many times as there are grains of sand in the Ganges. Renunciation does not help. Instead, it is the understanding that helps. Renouncing the world is not going to take you anywhere. You have to understand, renunciation is a stupid effort. Only stupid people renounce. The wise person tries to understand each situation. The wise is never an escapist. Only the stupid are escapists, because they cannot face life and take its challenges. They move to the mountains or escape to monasteries or somewhere else. They run away from the world. Buddha says these sutras are so valuable that even if you can listen totally with an open heart, if you are vulnerable to them, they can transform your life. Even something, a single word, can be such a transforming force. I have heard about a man who must have been like Hui Ning. He was very old, nearly 65 or 70. He had gone for a morning walk, and some woman must have been walking her son or somebody else inside a hut. The old man was on the road and the woman was saying, "It is time to get up. It is morning. It is no longer night." The old man heard these words, and it was not even the Diamond Sutra. It was just a woman telling someone, "Get up, it is enough. You have slept long. It is no longer night. The sun has risen, it is morning." And the old man heard this He must have been in some receptive state of mind. That morning, the birds singing, the sun and the cool breeze, and those words struck hard, like arrow in his heart. It is morning, you have slept too long, and it is no longer night. He went home, he went outside the town, sat in the temple meditating. People came to know about him, and the family came rushing, and they said, "What are you doing here?" He said, "It is morning, it is no longer night, and I have already slept enough. Enough is enough. Excuse me. Leave me alone. I have to wake up. Death is coming. I will wake up." Sometimes a few words, even uttered by ordinary people, can fall in the right soil of the heart and can bring great transformation. What to say of the words of Buddha? It is very rare that man of the quality of Subhuti will cry with tears flowing profusely. But when such compassion and love from Buddha is flowing, showering on him, when such diamond words are falling on him like rain, he is overwhelmed. Remember, there is no deeper way to relate your gratefulness than with tears. There is no higher way to pray than tears. Never be afraid of tears. The so-called civilization has made you afraid of tears. Tears are far more beautiful than anything that you have with you. Tears can come from the overflow of your being. Tears are not the necessity of sadness. Sometimes they spring out of great joy, and sometimes they come out of great peace and still. Sometimes they are the expression of ecstasy and love. In fact, tears have nothing to do with sadness or happiness. Anything that stirs your heart too much or takes possession of you, anything that too much that you cannot contain, is expressed through tears that starts overflowing. Accept them with great joy, nourish them and welcome them. It is through tears that you will know how to pray. Through tears you will know how to see. Tear-filled eyes are capable of seeing truth. Tear-filled eyes are capable of seeing the beauty of life and benediction of it. Subhuti says, your presence, the compassionate words, love and your grace, all has produced cognition in me. It has given me an insight, a vision of truth, and it is indeed no perception. Still, Subhuti will repeat the same words, but let me remind you, it is no perception, because there is nobody to perceive. It is pure cognition. It is pure.